I could have your attention, please. I hope everybody's had a good meal and I'm sure even better conversation. So I'm glad that you are enjoying yourselves. We are in for a real treat now. We are here to honor the 100th anniversary of Bill Casey's birth, and there could really be no better speaker to do that than the one you are about to hear from. You see, Herb Meyer was in the Reagan administration, special assistant to the director of the CIA, and he was also vice chairman of the CIA's National Intelligence Council. Now, in that position, he not only played a key role in developing the strategy that the Reagan administration employed, but he also managed the production of U.S. national intelligence estimates and other top secret projections for Reagan and his national security advisors. For those of you that have any familiarity with the intelligence community, the national intelligence estimates, NIEs, are the most substantial and crucial part of the sort of analytical product that is created. Herb was really the first figure in journalism in the 1970s who, as an associate editor of Fortune magazine, was talking about the fact that the Soviet Union was in decline and was going to eventually collapse if we could give it a push. When he was in his position as special assistant to the CIA director, he wrote a series of memos to Bill Casey talking about that very fact. And I would say I'm fortunate enough to quote from them extensively in my book, Reagan's War. Now, he is the host and producer of The Siege of Western Civilization, which is an excellent DVD. It outlines the threats to our security and our economy and our culture. It is an international bestseller. If you have a chance to get it, you need to get it. It's available online. He is also the author of several books, including The War Against Progress, Real World Intelligence, and Hard Thinking. They're co-authors of a book with his wife called How to Write, and it's one of the most widely read handbooks on writing. And what's going to be interesting in hearing from Herb is not only his ideas, but he's going to offer you incredible insights in how to convey and to communicate those ideas. He does a lot of speaking before corporations, corporate executives, and business organizations that are interested in the fundamental question of what is going on in the world. So I would like to very much introduce our speaker, Mr. Herb Meyer.
Thank you. Thank you, Peter. It's a great honor for me to be here this evening. Thank you for inviting me, and thank you for coming. And my thanks to the Young Americas Foundation. You've been very gracious hosts. This afternoon, they took several of us up to the President's Ranch. It's an extraordinary experience. And I discovered something quite unexpected. President and Mrs. Reagan had the same silverware that Jill and I have. We were given the set when we got married in 1977. We'd have it ever since. And I gave Jill a call this afternoon. I was telling her about the visit to the ranch, and I told her about the silverware. And she said, you know, after 35 years, we're down two knives and a fork. If one of you students is at the ranch this weekend and can give us a hand, and if you're not quite sure how to go about this, I would be happy to teach you what little I know about covert operations. Speaking of which, if Bill Casey had been hit by a bus while walking across the street in Manhattan in 1947, and this is not unimaginable since Bill liked to read while he walked, he would have gone down in history as one of our country's greatest spy masters. During the war, he was in London. He ran secret operations for the OSS, our intelligence service. And while he was doing that, he organized and directed more than 100 missions behind Nazi lines. Well, luckily for all of us, especially for Mrs. Casey and Bernadette, he wasn't hit by a bus in 1947. He built an extraordinary career in law, business, publishing, public service. And at the end of 1980, President-elect Ronald Reagan named Bill Casey Director of Central Intelligence. 5 years later, the Soviet Union was on its knees. 4 years after that, the Berlin Wall was down. 2 years after that, in December 1991, the Soviet Union ceased to exist and the Cold War was over. As the boys in the Kremlin would have said, this was not a coincidence. Bill Casey played a crucial role in helping President Reagan fight and win the Cold War. And on this, the 100th anniversary of Bill Casey's birth, it's wonderful that we can get together and talk about this extraordinary man, about what he did and how he did it. One point of protocol before we go any further. I know it would be more proper to refer to him as Mr. Casey or Director Casey, but in the years I was lucky enough to work for him, everybody called him Bill. There were about six people who just couldn't quite bring themselves to be that informal, but everyone else called him Bill. That's what he called himself, and that's what he liked to be called. And it had some odd moments. When Bill wanted to know something, he wanted to know it right now, this minute, and he didn't have time to mess around with bureaucratic lines of command. So he would simply pick up the phone and call whatever analyst knew the answer to his question. So we'd call some junior analyst in a windowless office on the third floor, say, hi, this is Bill. How many SS-20 missiles are there in East Germany? And this guy would say, oh, hi, Bill, 160, maybe 165. And Bill would say, okay, thanks, see ya. So this 25-year-old junior analyst, who was calling everybody above him sir, called the director Bill. It drove some of the bureaucrats nuts. So we'll call him Bill. To understand what he did, what he accomplished, and how he did it, you have to understand what the world was like in 1980. When World War II ended in 1945, immediately after that, we were in a Cold War. The Cold War was a titanic global struggle between the Soviet Union and the free world. The Soviet Union wanted to keep us so weak, so demoralized, we could never challenge their iron grip on their own people. All anybody wanted in the free world was to be left alone. And the rules of this global conflict were established very quickly. Whatever territory belonged to the Soviet Union was theirs. Whatever territory didn't belong to the Soviet Union was up for grabs. All through the 1950s, the 1960s, into the 1970s, every leader of every Western country had the same objective: to not lose the Cold War. If when you left office, the balance of power was the same as when you took office, or maybe not too much worse, then you'd been a success. In other words, we were playing defense. And when you play defense, you cannot possibly win. You just keep from losing, and that was the game. Well, by the middle of the 1970s, it wasn't going very well. Our economies were stagnant. Our military power was waning. The Russians seemed to be on the march everywhere. We were beginning to lose. And all through the West, more and more intellectuals were coming around to the view that, you know, you just can't keep fighting this. It's just going on forever. There's no way we can ever win. Why don't we just sort of surrender elegantly and cut a deal with the Soviet Union and be done with it? In 1979 and 1980, everything changed when the three most unlikely individuals stepped onto the world stage. They were a Polish Pope, John Paul II, a woman Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher, and an actor turned politician from here in California. I can explain to you the forces within the Catholic Church that led to the election of a Polish Pope. I can explain to you the political rivalries within Great Britain's Conservative Party that catapulted a woman to the leadership. I can even explain to you how an actor became President of the United States. I cannot explain to you how all three of these implausible events happened simultaneously. Unless, of course, you're willing to believe in miracles. And if you are willing to believe in miracles, I'll give you one more. All three of these world leaders survived assassination attempts. which is statistically impossible. John Paul, Margaret Thatcher, Ronald Reagan, they were not content to not lose the Cold War. They wanted to end the Cold War. They wanted to win it. And together, they threw the switch from playing defense to playing offense. And that was the great shift that changed the course of world history. President Reagan knew that to fight and win the Cold War, he was going to need a first-class intelligence service. And that's because President Reagan understood what the CIA is supposed to do. The CIA is the president's radar. It's the instrument he relies on to tell him what's going on out there before it's visible. In other words, to tell him what the future's going to be and to tell him soon enough and clearly enough so that the president can prepare for the future, and if the president doesn't like the future, well, he can change the future before it happens. And when a president wants to change the future, one of the most potent tools he's got is in the intelligence service, and that's covert action. Covert action means you can go overseas and do something nasty or awkward to our country's adversaries. You can throw a banana peel under their feet, maybe something a little more lethal. And you can do it in a way that doesn't leave American fingerprints all over the place. Well, to find the kind of man to lead the smart, aggressive intelligence service that he wanted, President Reagan didn't have far to look. Bill Casey was standing right next to him, literally. Bill had managed the president's 1980 presidential campaign. And unlike so many people in Washington who get big jobs because the one talent they have is the ability to push past all the rest of us to the front of the line, Bill actually knew how to do intelligence. Remember, he had done it. Now, President Reagan wanted to take a completely different approach to the Cold War. He wanted to fight it and win it. And to do that, he needed an accurate picture of what was going on in the Soviet Union. Just the way a 747 captain needs an accurate picture of the mountain range that's dead ahead of him. And this is where Bill Casey did what no one else could have done. He knew how to do it. By 1980, the CIA and just about everyone else believed that the Soviet economy was growing at an annual rate of over 3%. That's very good. We were growing at 3%. We wished we could keep growing at 3%. If the Soviet economy was growing at 3%, there's no way to end the Cold War. It's going to go on forever. President Reagan had an intuitive sense that couldn't be right. And some of us also did. You know, according to the CIA, the East German economy was the size of the California economy. Well, you know, some of us had been to California, we'd been to East Germany, didn't look the same. But intuition isn't the same as facts. Under Bill's leadership, here's what we did. We asked a question that had never been asked before. What if the Soviet economy isn't healthy? What if it's actually a basket case? And then we pulled together a team, and over a period of weeks, maybe even a couple of months, we made a list of everything you would find if it were true that the Soviet economy was in more trouble than anybody thought. The highly technical list of what you'd look for. Then we took that list and we gave it to our spies. We went around the world with it. We gave it to our colleagues at MI6, British Intelligence Service. We gave it to the DGM Bureau, France's Intelligence Service, Germany's BMD, Israel's Mossad. And at each of these meetings, we said, look, this is what we think may be happening. And if we're right, these are the kinds of things you'll find. We actually gave them that list. And then we took one more step. We said, look, if you actually find anything on this list, don't just put it in a weekly report or throw it in a file folder someplace. Get it into the director's office now. Now, we didn't have email then the way we do today, but we had special codes that would jump the whole system, get it into the director's office without anybody ever seeing it before it got there. What came in was absolutely astonishing. We had reports of shortages of food, of steel, even of soap in the Soviet Union. There were reports of factories that would shut down because of a shortage of fuel or of some vital raw material like titanium, for example. We found industrial managers juggling production, fiddling with the numbers. We found operations going on inside the Kremlin to fiddle things around so nobody quite knew how bad things were. And at one point, I would turn to all these people and say, look, all this stuff that's coming in, how come we never saw this before? And the answer was, you never said you wanted it. And we found out something quite extraordinary. The CIA had been built to monitor Soviet strengths, mostly military strengths, and understandably so. It had never been built to monitor Soviet weaknesses. So whenever something came up that was a Soviet weakness, it wasn't relevant. Kind of threw it in a pile in the corner of the office. Well, by 1980, that pile was just about up to the ceiling, and no one ever looked at the pile. And suddenly we said, wait a minute, what's over there? And we found it. One reason I'm going on and on about what we did under Bill's leadership and how we did it is because this is what did not happen before 9/11. The people running our intelligence service then didn't know how to do intelligence. They never asked the right question. And the right question was, what if Al-Qaeda is already in the United States planning an attack? So they never made a list of what you would find if that were the case. Since there was no list, they never gave it to anybody. Not just our spies, but police departments, FBI, because you're looking inside the United States. No one was ever told what to look out for. And since no one was ever told what to look out for, they were never told what to do with anything if they found it. In other words, there was no one in Washington waiting for it. No official in Washington kind of leaning over the red telephone waiting for it to ring. So when FBI agents in Phoenix and Minneapolis discovered there were single men from the Mideast in the United States paying cash for flying lessons and saying, teach me to fly a 767, but don't bother teaching me how to land because I won't need to know that. That was on no one's list to report. That's how 9/11 happened. And by the way, the 9/11 Commission missed that completely. Well, Bill Casey knew how to do intelligence. And in the end, we got our hands on the biggest secret of the Cold War. It wasn't the Soviet Union's nuclear codes, wasn't the secret location of their ICBM silos, wasn't even the name of the French cabinet minister who was actually a KGB spy. Sorry. Name of the two French cabinet ministers who were. The biggest secret of the Cold War, the one thing that above all else the Kremlin didn't want us to know, is that the Soviet economy wasn't growing. It was beginning to implode. That was the biggest secret of the Cold War, and we got it. Now, armed with that intelligence, President Reagan had the confidence to launch his program for winning the Cold War. And now you can understand why the president launched the biggest arms buildup since the end of World War II. We weren't looking for a war, but as the Soviet economy was under such enormous pressure, matching our arms buildup was more than they could handle. We did that to put the pressure on them. Now you can see why we put so much pressure on our European allies to limit their purchases of Soviet natural gas, which the Soviet Union exported to Europe. As the Soviet economy was beginning to implode, they had a terrible shortage of hard currency. And they needed hard currency to purchase stuff they couldn't produce anymore, including wheat, by the way. Well, the whole point of that program, covert and overt, to keep the Europeans from getting their hands on Russian natural gas is to deny them the hard currency. That's what that was about. And now you can see why President Reagan's Missile Defense Plan, Strategic Defense Initiative, was the proverbial bullet between the eyes that ended the Cold War. Look, The Russians knew SDI could be made to work. Not tomorrow, not next week, not in a decade, maybe not in 20 years, but they knew missile defense could be made to work. It was their scientists who actually invented the idea. So they knew that if we launched a missile defense program, we could do it. Except we could afford to do it, because under President Reagan's leadership, the US economy was on the verge of the greatest economic boom in modern history. And they were on the verge of collapse. And if they had to match our missile defense program, they'd be bankrupt overnight. And this is what the president's critics never understood when they sneeringly referred to missile defense, SDI, as Star Wars. I was sitting in an interesting chair at the time, and an interesting perception on all this. President Reagan gave that famous televised speech in which he announced missile defense on March 23rd, 1983. The next morning, March 24th, I was in my office, and I was looking through the overnight traffic coming in from Moscow. Everything had changed. The Kremlin understood in a nanosecond that President Reagan had just fired the fatal shot. There was complete panic in the Kremlin and in the military establishment. Now what do we do? And by the way, President Reagan used to describe missile defense as a shield over the United States. The man was a political genius. It was a lid over the Soviet Union. It meant that missiles weren't going to fly. And I was sitting there reading this intelligence, and again, less than 24 hours after the speech, the Kremlin knew it was over. And at one point, I just put down all the cables, got a cup of coffee, and I picked up the morning editions of the Washington Post and the New York Times to see what they were saying about the president's speech. What they were saying is the amiable idiot in the White House had now finally lost contact with reality. It was an extraordinary change between the cables coming in from Moscow and the Washington Post. Yeah. Well, it took more than economic warfare to end the Cold War. It took military action, took bullets. And once again, Bill Casey and his CIA were right in the middle of it. Remember, the guiding principle of the Cold War is that whatever territory belonged to the Russians was theirs. Whatever didn't belong to them was up for grabs. Well, President Reagan threw that guiding principle right out the window. And we began to support anti-communist insurgencies around the world. For example, Afghanistan, Ethiopia, Nicaragua, El Salvador, Angola, Mozambique. And you've got to understand what this looked like to Moscow. To their way of looking at the world, the correlation of forces could only go in one direction. You could have a communist insurgency, but you couldn't have an anti-communist insurgency. That was a logical impossibility. Well, now there are half dozen of them around the world. President Reagan had completely changed the rules of the game. And for the first time, we were on offense and they were on defense. Now, historians can argue forever about the tactics we used, whether we were successful here, not successful there. The point to keep in mind is we had thrown the switch. Now we were playing offense, they were on defense, and you know what? They didn't like playing defense. And you know what else? They weren't very good at it. And now you can see why our invasion of Grenada in 1983 played such an outsized role in winning the Cold War. Grenada is a small island in the Caribbean. The Russians and the Cubans had turned it into a military base. It was sort of an unmovable, unsinkable aircraft carrier in our front yard. It was a threat, but an immortal threat. So we invaded, we threw them out. By the way, Grenada is not that important. It's the world's leading supplier of nutmeg. This was the first time we had taken one of their pieces off the board. That's why it was important. And what they were saying in Moscow is, if this president's going to take one of our pieces off the board, what piece might he go for next? How about Poland. I want to tell you a story about President Reagan and Bill Casey that you've never heard before. I know you haven't heard it before because I'm the only one who knows it and I've never told anyone. From the moment John Paul II sat on the throne of St. Peter's, the Kremlin knew it had a big problem on its hands. His objective was the liberation of his beloved Poland. 2 years later, Ronald Reagan was president of the United States, and he kept talking about Poland and the oppressed Polish people. And the president and the Pope were in very close communications. You will not be surprised to learn that one of the links in the secret chain that connected them was Bill Casey. The Polish Pope had moral authority. The American president had more than 100,000 armed troops in Europe. What the Kremlin understood very, very clearly is that if they lost Poland, the Cold War was over. Poland was the linchpin of the entire Soviet Empire. They always knew it was the linchpin. They believed that deeply. Remember, our military alliance was called NATO. Their military alliance was called the Warsaw Pact. Well, there's no Warsaw Pact without Warsaw. If you lose Poland, it's over, okay? In May 1981, while riding through St. Peter's Square, John Paul was shot. Miraculously, he survived the assassin's bullets. Even more miraculously, he survived the Rome hospital they took him to. From the moment those shots were fired, it's true. From the moment those shots were fired, serious people began to ask, wait a minute, was that young Turkish gunman acting alone? Or was there more to it? Was something else going on here? Bill Casey's orders were very, very clear. We stay out of this. We don't go near it. If word leaked out that at the CIA we were even thinking of looking into this, the political explosion would have blown the dome off Capitol Hill and fractured the NATO alliance. Let me tell you, there were some very nasty confrontations at the CIA about all of this. What happened? What might have happened? Should we look into this? Dare we look into this? And when I say they were nasty confrontations, I'm not kidding. Look, I grew up in Brooklyn. I know a nasty confrontation when I say one. I'm not talking about somebody wrote a nasty memo or somebody said something unpleasant at a staff meeting. I'm talking about serious pushing and shoving in the stairwells and in the underground parking garage. Okay, this was a mess. It was really nasty, and Bill's orders were very clear. We stay out of this. Well, sort of. When the fuss died down a little bit, everybody stopped obsessing over this. Very quietly, Bill ginned up an analytic team to take a look at this. Very quietly, very carefully. Got some young analysts, by the way, and especially some young women. Their careers weren't going very well. They weren't getting the promotions they should have, but they're really smart. And gave them a chance to show what they could do. We got to the bottom of it. We learned what happened, how it happened, who was involved, who wasn't involved. We got it. This is not the time and place to go into those details. In any case, I don't have the legal authority to declassify US government secrets. What I want to tell you is that everything we learned is in one document. At the time we produced it, this was the most secret document ever produced by the CIA. And I'm not exaggerating about the secrecy. It was way beyond top secret. Okay? In fact, I remember in the office we were cracking bad jokes that if this were the KGB, we'd shoot the typist. Okay, we're talking about that kind of secrecy, okay? Anyway, on the day the document was complete, Bill was going to go down to the White House and brief the president. And he was looking forward to it. He really felt that, you know, for once we really got in front of it, really had this thing nailed. And I wanted to brag a little bit about the CIA and what we'd done. I think he was looking for a presidential pat on the back. anyway, I was waiting for him in his office when he got back. And as he took off his hat and coat, I said, how did it go with the president? And he laughed. He said, only Reagan. Guy's amazing. He said, sitting there telling him about this, so I'm holding this report in my hands, kind of rolled up in his hand, and I'm waving it around. I said, you know, Mr. President, we did it. We got to the bottom of it. We found out what happened. We got it all here. He said, Reagan interrupted me. He said, Bill, can I read that? Do I have the clearances to read that? And Bill said, love. He said, only Reagan. He said, any other president would have just ripped it out of my hands. Reagan asked. I said, Mr. President, you own this document. And I gave it to him. I never saw that document again. Nor have I met anyone else who's ever seen that document again. There should be a copy of it somewhere in CIA files, but I'm not sure there is. There should certainly be that president's copy at the Reagan Library, but I'm not sure there is. May I suggest that maybe Monday somebody go down to the Reagan Library and take a look for that? Maybe at midnight? Now, as I said before, I won't leak the contents of that document. But I'll send a bottle of whiskey to whoever does. Okay? That's a biggie. Take a look, would you please? I just have a feeling it's not there. Working for Bill Casey was a once-in-a-lifetime experience. He'd been everywhere. He'd done everything. He seemed to know everybody in the world. Bill had a Rolodex the size of a Ferris wheel. And if you happen to mention it, you're going to be such and such a country next week. Bill would go there, look, well, look, you got to look up so-and-so here. I did business with him 20 years ago. I knew him 30 years ago. Take him out for a drink. I'll tell you what's going on. So you call this guy, you say you're working for Bill. He'd meet you for a drink somewhere or dinner, tell you Bill Casey stories all night, and you learned more from this guy than you could learn from an embassy. I mean, he just knew everybody. He was a voracious reader. I simply do not understand how he read so many books. There was a library at the CIA, and inside the library was something called the Special Historic Collection, the Historic Intelligence Collection. There's a lovely old gentleman who ran it. He'd been with the CIA since 1947. The Historic Intelligence Collection had stuff you won't find in your local library. And every book on intelligence that had ever been written, espionage, a lot of them that had never been published, some that had never been translated into English, but we had translations of them, some things that had been smuggled out of Soviet prisons and things like that, and they were notated. And whenever I had some time, I'd go down, I'd chat with this wonderful librarian, and he said, no, he wants you to read this. And he would say, well, you read this because this is real and that's made up. Or that's actually the code name for this guy, and that was real. It was just a remarkable education. And he told me once that Bill Casey was his best customer. He'd never had a director who spent so much time coming down reading books. Bill would borrow a bunch of books before a weekend, bring them back Monday. And he said he would bring them back, drop them on the desk, and he'd start asking questions about, well, page 86 in this book and page 72 in that one. He said he'd just never seen anything like it. A director could read that much. And it wasn't just books. As best I can figure it out, there were several dozen newsletters and magazines to which Bill Casey was the world's only subscriber. I don't mean that I didn't read it. I mean, I'd never heard of it, and I never met anyone who'd ever heard of it. We'd be sitting in his office chatting about Europe or something. And he'd say, oh, I guess you saw that article in the new edition of the Luxembourg Gold Quarterly. The what? And he'd get up. And he'd start to rummage through one of the four briefcases he used to lug around. Inexplicably, whenever he was looking for something, it was always in the fourth briefcase. He never started with the right one. But he'd finally find it, and he just threw it across the desk at me. And I was slinking out of his office with this Luxembourg Gold Quarterly or whatever. And I heard him muttering behind my back, how the hell am I supposed to work with guys who don't read? And he was awful. I once mentioned this to Ambassador Gene Kirkpatrick. Now, Gene was one of the most intelligent, well-read human beings who ever walked the earth. And she laughed and said, you know, the same thing happens to me when I talk with him. So I didn't feel quite so badly.
Always happened to me, too.
Yeah. Bill didn't live to see the end of the Cold War. That's a shame. But he knew where it was going. He had put in place the forces that would bring down the Soviet Union. Now, he was a very busy man. When he was in the office, he had more appointments than your average Washington, D.C. dentist. I mean, it was incredible. But sometimes, late afternoon, things would slow down a little bit. He liked to chat. And by the way, when you chatted with Bill, he would sit in his big leather chair. He never took off his jacket in the office. It'd be 100 degrees out. He was wearing his jacket, you know, suit jacket in the office. And he would lean back in his leather chair, and he would always be bending and twisting a paper clip. Could make you crazy, watching this paper clip bend and twist, and he would do this. So anyway, we were chatting about Russia and the world, and he said something that I thought was very profound, and it deserves more attention from historians than it's gotten. He said, you know, Herb, probably not a lot of fun to be a member of the Politburo. He said, what? He said, look, that's a different political system. It's not like here. He said, in that system, you kill your way to the top. And if you lose power, there's nowhere to go. No boards of directors, no foundations. I mean, there's nothing there. He says, even you're at the top, every night you gotta sleep worried you're gonna get murdered in your bed. He said, by the time you get there, you know, you just wanna relax a little bit, enjoy it, maybe get to your dacha at a decent hour, sit there and have a drink. He said, look, those Politburo meetings, they go on for hours now. He said, we're pushing their economy all over the place. We got anti-communist insurgencies all over the country. They just can't catch their breath. President's driving them crazy, talking about evil empire. Missile defense gonna bankrupt them. He said, they can't catch their breath. He said, you know, these guys are exhausted. He said, if we can keep up the pressure a little while longer, we got them. Well, we kept up the pressure a while longer, and we got him. Bill Casey was one of President Reagan's most controversial appointments. There were a lot of people in Washington who wanted the president to dump Bill and give that job to someone else. Not just people in the House of Representatives and the Senate, but people inside the administration. Boy, did he have some powerful enemies. There wasn't a chance in the world President Reagan was going to dump Bill. And that's because the president knew something about Bill that seems to have eluded all of his political enemies. Remember what I said earlier? The most important role of our intelligence service is to be the president's radar, to tell him what the future's going to be and to tell him the future soon enough and clearly enough so the president can prepare for the future, or if he doesn't like the future, change the future before it happens. Now, for those of you too young to remember all of this, the leader of the Soviet Union was Leonid Brezhnev. Brezhnev took power in the Kremlin in 1964. Which is before Ronald Reagan even entered politics. Okay? Brezhnev was an old school, hardline, vicious commie. And the chances of ever working with him to ease global tensions were non-existent. Well, by the time President Reagan was in the White House, Brezhnev was old, he was sick. And all over the world, everybody was on edge in foreign ministries, defense ministries, wondering what's going to happen next. Who comes next? Where's this going? What's going to happen? Finally, in November 1962, Brezhnev died. More accurately, on November 10th, 1982, someone in the Kremlin noticed that Leonid Brezhnev wasn't breathing. That afternoon, the CIA went into massive overdrive. I've never seen anything like it. Reports were coming in from every section, every division in the building, impact of Brezhnev's death on Kremlin politics, on the Soviet Union, on East Europe, on the NATO alliance, on relations with China, on Japan. CIA station chiefs in countries I'd never heard of were sending in reports. You know, impact of Brezhnev's death on the politics of Upper Volga, things like that. And at one point in the afternoon, I walked into Bill's office and said, anything I can do to help you out? By the way, it was an amazing sight. He had a huge desk, and it was just piled with reports coming in. And even as we were talking, Betty Murphy, who was his wonderful assistant, Betty was coming in with more stuff. I mean, it was almost like a comedy in a movie, just stuff being loaded onto the desk. I said, anything I can do to help you? And he just looked at it. He said, nah. I said, get out of here. He said, I want to boil all this down for the president. Well, went back to my office. About an hour later, I thought, gee, before I go home, we ought to check one more time. So I walked back in just to see if there's anything he wanted me to do. And Bill was sitting there, and he was reading a document. It's one or one and a half pages. He had dictated his memo to Betty. She had typed it. And now he was just going over it. And he was looking at it very, very carefully, reading it slowly, almost sort of closing his eyes. He wanted to make sure it was just what he wanted. And then finally just thought about it for a second, almost as though he was praying for a minute. He was sort of looking at it. And then he picked up a pen, scribbled a signature on it, and he threw it across the desk. He said, here, this is what I'm sending to the president. Take a look if you want. In one or two paragraphs, he summed up what had happened and what everybody thought the future might bring. I have never seen more information and more insight packed more densely into fewer words, more clearly and more concisely. I mean, no one could have done that. But it was the last sentence that caught my eye and always makes me laugh whenever I think of what an extraordinary man this was. As for me, Mr. President, I bet Andropov on the nose and Gorbachev across the board. Bill. Whoa. In one breezy sentence, he told the president the next two Soviet leaders. By the way, a corpse named Chernyenko was propped up between them for a few months. He got them both. Do you realize President Reagan knew the Soviet Union's future leaders before the Kremlin knew it? Okay? And that's what Bill's enemies never understood. And that's what the president understood. Bill Casey wasn't just a little smarter, a little tougher than anybody else you could put in at the CIA. He was one of a kind. Bill Casey was a crystal ball in a pinstripe suit. That's what he was. Now, Washington's changed a lot in the years since President Reagan was in the White House, not necessarily for the better. I doubt we will ever again see a man like Bill Casey in charge of our country's intelligence service. That's too bad. The world's a dangerous place. But as I hope I've been able to show you this evening, he was one of a kind, and we were very lucky to have had him then when we needed him the most. And thank you for listening to me. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Herb, for those incredible insights. He obviously continues to follow world events very closely, is in high demand as a speaker before lots of audience on the subjects. If there are some questions that you'd like to ask, Herb has agreed to answer some of them. It could be about current world events, America's strategy in the world, President Obama's foreign policy or lack of one. So any questions out there? We've got some microphones. Please raise your hand and we'll get a microphone to you.
And right now, around the world, a lot of governments, a lot of countries are getting a bad case of the shakes, which is, what if the Americans don't do that anymore? What if they won't come when we're in trouble? What if we check out? Now, nobody ever says this out loud because it's sort of uncool to say we need you Americans. They won't do that. But when you, you know, had access to the secret stuff, what you knew what they said to one another privately, boy, were they glad we were there. And I don't have access to the secret stuff anymore, but I know what they're saying, which is, yikes, what if the Americans won't come and rescue us next time? And that's what you've got. We'll see.
Next question. Yes.
Mr. Meyer, I read your interview in the Limbaugh letter, and
you were the one.
You offered us some hope.
Rush will be thrilled.
You offered us some hope. Would you mind summarize a little of that? I think we could use a little hope.
Oh, no, it's interesting. Rush called me a few weeks ago And he said, you know, since the election, everyone he knows is on suicide watch. And he knew that I'm sort of the optimist. Remember, I'm the one who told Reagan we're about to win the Cold War. And I'm actually an optimist. Obviously, we have serious problems. When you look at the world today, let me give you a way to look at it that isn't getting in the newspapers. You know, sometimes the best way to see where you're going is to know where you've been, how you got there. Just for a moment, let's press the rewind button, go back into history. Go back to Europe, end of the 17th century, 1690, 1695, something like that. Life was terrible. Lifespan was mid-40s. Most people were half starved most of the time. They prayed that when the next famine came, at least some of your children might survive. People were illiterate, uneducated. Women weren't allowed to be educated. Nobody traveled. You spent your whole life within 20 miles of where you'd been born. You had no say in how you were governed. You're a peasant, you're a serf. You shut up and did what you were told. Nothing changed. Life was static. The way you plowed the field till your grandfather did it, till your grandson would do it if you're the woman of the house. The way you washed clothes and prepared meals, that's how your grandmother did it, till your granddaughter would do it. You know, life was unchanging. The modern world is a very different place. In the modern world, lifespan is nearly 80. Incomes vary widely, bother some people. No one's starving. For the first time in history, we have a society, the modern world, it's no starvation. Do you realize what an extraordinary accomplishment that is? It's so extraordinary that today we are told accurately that the biggest health problem faced by poor people is obesity. Isn't that astonishing? We're educated, we're literate, women are educated, they run businesses, run for political office, travel. We have a huge say in how we're governed, don't always like the outcome of elections, but we have a say in how we're governed, and nothing stays the same. The technical word for the kind of change we live with is industrial productivity. The moment someone comes along and says, you know, there's a better way to do that. That person starts a business, they hire people, standards of living go up, the whole industry doing it. Then somebody has a second idea, and there's a second industry, third, fourth. And then 5, 10, 30 years later, someone comes up with a new technology, wipes out the first industry, there's a new first industry, then a new second one, new third. It's like an escalator that never actually stops. Like any piece of machinery, that escalator can break down. If it does, and you're not holding on tightly, you get hurt. And then the escalator picks up and it goes. That's the modern world, that's how we live. Our transition to the modern world wasn't smooth and seamless. The 18th and 19th centuries were violent. The 20th century was ghastly. World War I, World War II, Korea, Vietnam, Bosnia, fascism, communism. Look what it took to get us here. When you look at the Islamic world today and around the world, you're looking at 1.5 billion people beginning to make the journey we began more than 300 years ago. And what we keep saying to these people is, can't you guys do this by next Thursday? No, it's going to take them longer. Look what it took us. It won't take them 300 years, but it won't take them 3 weeks. What you're looking at now in the world is the Islamic world and some of the other parts of the world beginning to write the code for version 2.0. Figuring out how to reconcile their faith with the modern world as we did centuries ago. That's one of the greatest moments in world history. We're living through it. So don't be discouraged. If you look at what the 18th and 19th centuries were to us, the mistakes we made in the 20th century, sure, it's going to be difficult. And unlike all the talking heads on television who think that when you solve a problem, there are no more problems. In the real world, when you solve a problem, now you have a new set of problems. You know, you win World War II and you're in the middle of a Cold War. You end the Cold War, Yugoslavia blows apart. I mean, you just go from one set of problems to another, so don't be discouraged. But what you're looking at is the world becoming modern. And if you push this forward, we won't take the time to go into all the numbers. Within the lifetimes of those of you here tonight who were students, rest of us may not quite make it, but within your lifetimes, and my children's lifetimes, the world will cross a line that's never been crossed before. For the first time ever, the world will be out of poverty. The majority of human beings will no longer be poor. And many of you in this room this evening will live to see it. So yeah, I'm an optimist. Everything's going to take longer than you want. It's going to cost more. God knows we make mistakes, whether we're Republicans, Democrats, liberals, or conservatives. But boy, when you see how quickly the world is reconciling with modernity, emerging from poverty, wow. I cannot imagine a more hopeful, more optimistic, or exciting time to be young, to be alive, to be an American. So I'm your optimist. I know that was a long answer to your question, but you asked. So.
How did the CIA miss on weapons of mass destruction in Iraq?
I wasn't there, but here's what I think happened. I was this comes back to your dad, chatting with Bill one night in the office. And he usually didn't want to talk about politics because he was running the CIA, but yeah, sometimes, you know, it was late, got a little bored, maybe we're having a drink at the house or something, I forget. And he said, you know, Herb, said, you ever get to be president, first thing you do, get control of the CIA and the Justice Department. And I said, oh, why? He said, those are the two agencies that can destroy a president. Wow. President Reagan had control of both. Ed Meese ran Justice, Bill ran the CIA. Okay? President Bush had control of neither one. Okay? And those guys at the CIA undercut him. That's what happened. Okay? 75% of my job was to help Bill make sure the CIA didn't undercut the president. Not to cook the books, to uncook the books. I'll give you an example of that. The question when we were there is the Soviet Union sponsoring terrorism? That was the question on the table. Al Haig, the Secretary of State, said, yes, they are. And he was in a lot of hot water for saying that. Some people said, oh, no, they would never do something like that. And some of us said, yeah, I'm sure they would, but you can't prove it. You haven't got it. Anyway, one day, we had satellite photographs of what everyone agreed were terrorist training camps. I forget now, on the DS, it was East Germany, Czechoslovakia, and again, it's been a long time, maybe it was Bulgaria, but it was in the middle of East Europe, okay? Everyone understood these were terrorist training camps. So I called a meeting of everybody. I said, well, doesn't this mean they're sponsoring terrorism? And they said, well, we don't have any evidence of that. Well, the photograph's the evidence. I said, look, this isn't the remote mountainous region of Waziristan. This is East Germany. That's a school over there. That's a shopping center. That's a church where Bach played the organ. It is impossible the government doesn't know that terrorist camp's there. And if they know it's there, Moscow knows that it's there. Moscow knows every time these guys change their undershorts. Don't we have evidence of that? And they looked at me and said, well, we don't have any evidence. Well, you know, you can have that conversation and go crazy. So what actually happened is I took the photograph, okay, walked into the director's office, and I gave it to your dad. And I said, this is what you got. And the next thing I know, he took the photograph, folded it in three parts, put it in a suit jacket, and put on his hat and coat. It's only one person he's going to talk to. Okay? Well, the point is we got the president the right intelligence, okay? We blew past all the bureaucratic baloney. President Bush never had his guys at the CIA. And I think they undercut him. They wouldn't get him the right information. And I think that's what happened. Yes?
We're seeing a lot in the news recently about, over here, my name is Justin from Point Loma Nazarene. Yeah. We're seeing a lot in the news recently about North Korea and their development of nuclear missiles and also working on long-range missiles themselves. And we're also seeing controversy in Iran with the same type of problem. With your intelligence and just kind of your history with that, what do you think the best approach for the United States will be with dealing with these new threats that are being made?
There are two great lessons of the 20th century. First great lesson is crazy people sometimes get political power. I mean, Hitler was crazy. Idi Amin in Uganda, the maniacs in Cambodia killed 2 million of their own people. Actually, it's amazing how often crazy people get political power. And the second great lesson of the 20th century is When crazy people with political power tell you what they're going to do, believe them. They're not kidding. And of all the people who learned that lesson, it's the Israelis. Yes. You can go back to Germany, 1936, 37, even into 1938. There were Jewish families that could have gotten out of Germany, and they stayed. They owned businesses, they had beautiful homes, kids were in good schools, good lines of credit with their bankers in Frankfurt and Zurich, probably had season tickets to the Berlin Philharmonic. And they watched the Nazis take power, and they'd meet with each other at their clubs, their homes, and they say, look, this is quite distasteful, these guys are lunatics. What are they gonna do, kill us all? Yeah, as a matter of fact, should have believed them. I don't think the Jewish people will make that mistake a second time. Getting wiped out by a lunatic once was enough. So the answer to your question is, when the Israelis believe it's time, they will launch. Whether that's tomorrow, next Tuesday, or 2 years from now, I couldn't tell you. But they will launch. We'll see. Buckle your seatbelts.
What happens if they launch?
What happens if they launch? The United Nations will go berserk. There will be a nasty editorial in the New York Times. And most of the civilized world will go, whew, what a relief. That's what will happen.
It's going to stop there?
Well, you know, Napoleon's advice to his generals, when you start to take Vienna, take Vienna. The problem isn't the Iranian nuclear bomb, it's the regime. Take out the regime, then you don't have a problem. But we'll see. I don't know what will happen, obviously, but I think it's coming to a head. And the one thing I'm reasonably sure about is Benjamin Netanyahu, or whoever his successor might be, does not want to go down in history as the Prime Minister of Israel who was sitting in his office working on the New York Times crossword puzzle when Iran got the nuclear bomb. So something will happen.
One final question.
What's your opinion of John Brennan, and what do you see in the future of peace?
I knew John Brennan back then. The thought of John as director of intelligence, you know, if you read in the newspapers next week that I'd become a 747 captain, would you be surprised? Would it strike you as, what? That's how it strikes me. Huh? So just, it's unimaginable to me. We'll see. We'll hope for the best.
What are we going
to
do?
Well, we'll find a way to survive.
Thank you very much. Right?
Thank you. Thank you.
If I could have your attention, please. I hope everybody's had a good meal.